der hat legal problems, weißt du? One of them being that you have absolutely no guarantee about to which part of the body the recipient applies the device. Now, you see that I take my work extremely seriously. And in fact, if you were to look me up in a book of reference, you would find under my hobbies dignified practical joking. And this is the EFS given you an example of how this happens. Back to something more serious. Somebody put to us the requirement of taking periodic blood samples automatically. And this was a device which did it. It was unfortunately knocked on the head by HIV. But the way it was done was very simple. This was a little, effectively tiny plastic syringe. But there's a spring here, which was trying to push a piston in that direction and suck something into this end here. There was a rod of a low melting point alloy, which melted at something like 80 degrees or so. And one end of it butted against an ordinary resistor. And by running a current through the resistor, making it hot, the rod melted and got shorter and shorter and shorter. And in this way, sucked blood into the device. A very simple, remotely controlled syringe, which could be made to work at different speeds, depending how hot you really made the other device. And I think it still is a viable system if anybody is interested in taking blood samples at regular intervals from somebody. And there was a bag of anticoagulant, or dilutant, or whatever you wanted to mix with a blood sample, which was sucked in at the same time. But we had this just now, didn't we? And now I come to much more relatively more recent times. This was the beginning of my space career. This was a glove box. We were asked by NASA and ESA to make a glove box which, if you spilled formalin inside it, would not leak by more than 1 milligram of formalin in a week. And this seemed to be impossible. We made such a device. It is now the glove box is now the most flown bit of scientific equipment which NASA uses, because we had a trick of continuously cleaning up the atmosphere inside this device by circulating the air through filters based really on the NATO gas mask filter. And there are lots of them about, including some Russian ones of different sizes. So this got us launched into the space industry. Here's some stuff which we made, and which is actually on the space station now. The problem was that there was a great disagreement between a control specimen of cells grown on Earth at 1G and a control specimen on a spacecraft on a centrifuge at 1G. They didn't, and we believed this was due to the fact that in unfreezing the cells, they were at least for an hour or so exposed to zero gravity, effectively, which unfroze the cells without them ever seeing anything less than 1G. But the only control we applied to the device was how fast the centrifuge inside was rotating. If it was rotating very fast, certain pistons were spun outwards and sucked things. If you lower the speed, the springs pushed them inwards. So all the liquid switching and control inside them, of washing the cells, spinning them down, sucking them out again, was all done merely by modulating the speed of the centrifuge without any electronics in them at all. I'll have to stop there, because this brings me into the present, and I won't show you the slide, I'll merely tell you what I'm doing. I coined the term tools for living in the 1970s to describe technology which was used to improve the quality of life of elderly or otherwise vulnerable people. And I've really worked solidly on this for the last 10 years or so, say being 81 myself, so I have a vested interest. We've built intelligent houses which talk to you and argue with you and so on, before calling for aid. They try to talk you out of what you were doing, which seemed to be dangerous. These are the rather more typical people. In 10 of these we had in Greenwich, off the housing list, who quite enjoyed living in these houses which actually talked to them and told them what to do or what not to do. Here's a device which I've just heard my local authority is going to use. It's a computer, a laptop computer, without a keyboard, because we discovered that all old people, can operate a barcode reader. So if the barcode reader is the only way of telling the computer about anything, and we've now got about 100 applications, from simple shopping, they can merely show the tin of tomato soup to the device or from a catalog, to sending emails. It works out what you want to do and selects the appropriate program, and that's a lot. Thank you very much.